What's up, guys? Mustang 2005 here, and I'm back at the Conference House Park. They're having a tour today, which is awesome because last week it was closed and now it's open. It's a good thing I saw that because I wouldn't have known. Someone random posted about it on Facebook and I wouldn't have known. So that's pretty awesome. We're gonna get a tour over there, so let's go over there. It's the visitor center. So anyway, I'll see you guys over there.
What's great about today? It's free. It's free. No donations.
Dennis is a
wonderful docent.
Thank you.
Who are you filming for, sir?
No, I just for you two.
Okay.
Here, actually.
Please give credit to the conference.
Oh yeah, definitely.
I just don't live here anymore.
Hi, I talked to somebody in the office. I'm a freelance writer working on a story.
Deb Woodbridge, I'm the curator.
Oh, hi. Nice to meet you.
You wanted to get a tour from Dennis, so if you don't mind stepping aside for one moment, let the other people in. That would be wonderful.
And you wanted to, and I'm Dennis, okay? It's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Todd Villian is now over here.
Wonderful. Dennis, the gentleman that is particularly needing your attention, I think I spoke to you, or did I forget to call you? I am. This gentleman is a freelance writer, and he writes here. So, if you could please accommodate him with a tour of the house, that would be wonderful. James, I'd like you to meet Dennis.
Is this the man?
This is the man.
This
is
Dennis.
Dennis.
How did you forget my name?
I'm Dennis, that's it. So, I'm going to give one of my cards. Now, you want to take pictures of the house in what way?
Yeah, sure. Okay, that's fabulous. Thank you so much.
No problem.
It's just that this happens to be a free day, which means
we'll pass my
soul around. It seems to build calm to in relation to campus.
Wow. This is really old. Very elegant. I guess someone would do their writings there. Old clock over there. Sorry for all the background noise, but there's a lot of people here. There's nothing I can really do about that. And there was no way I can come any earlier because this is when it opens, so. Apparently there's someone else here that wanted to come do like a documentary type thing. And they were saying, you know, there's gonna be a lot of people here. I've been in the basement before. They had a play down there. It was pretty interesting. I don't know if we're going to be able to see the basement today, though. But it's like a really old cellar type. Here in the 1600s, 1700s, here in Staten Island, that's amazing. And the historical, and all the historical things that have gone on here, that's amazing. George Washington was here, Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, they were all here. I'm sorry if this is shaky. They were all here signing trying to sign a peace treaty. I don't know if this is the room, it might have been that room. Probably that room. I'll go ask them. Walked away before I got a chance to ask, but let's go up. Oh, I didn't see this clock here. Look at this whole clock. I guess you can go to the basement. We'll see that after. So this is another open tour. They said 3 o'clock is when they would actually talk about it. Oh, wow. I don't know if I'm going to wait until 3 o'clock, though. It's 2 hours from now. So I guess this would be the master bedroom. This is like a mansion in 1600s times. Look at that little chair, a little rocking chair. There's a little bed here. Unfortunately, you can't go into the room because there's a barrier here, but that's okay. I got my little tripod on here. Hopefully, it's a little bit more steady than the other video. I guess you would do some knitting. It's cool. Camera got caught. Oh, wow. Like Rumpelstiltskin. In there. Probably just storage. Well, maybe this is the master's quarters. Maybe that was the woman's quarters. Who knows? Probably sit there, relax with a nice cigar. I don't know who that is. Probably someone famous, though. And I'm probably gonna look like an idiot because it's probably someone obvious, but I don't really remember history too much. It's probably like John Adams or some crap. Or maybe that's Christopher Philip himself. I don't know. Kane over there. Let's go check out the basement. This is the basement. As you see, they have all these chairs here because they do plays. Not as creepy as everyone makes it out to be, but I'm sure at night it is. It's supposed to be ghost stories about this place. Let me adjust my shutter here. These old silverware stuff. Linen press. Interesting. Radiator. They didn't have radiators back then. That must be a new installation. Well, not new, but you know what I mean. Guess they would eat dinner down here. Pretty much it. This is the basement, and that's the whole house. Let me go see if I could ask for some information so you guys have some information about this place.
King is ticked off. He wants to get this done with, but he wants his two best men, the Howe brothers, Lord Howe of the Navy, General Howe of the Army, sends them across and says, talk to this guy, George Washington, because he can negotiate. He's a patrician just like us. He's a wealthy landowner. We could deal with him. Okay. So they come across, you know, Howe's here, and they send letters to New Jersey where George is, you know. And the bottom line is, George gets letters, but he never answers them. Finally, Howe goes, what's the deal? You know, I send him three letters and he refuses to answer the letters. So then Howe sends a contingent of soldiers to go there with a flag saying, why can't George Washington? Well, Mr. George Washington will not answer the letters because he was never called General Washington of the Continental Army. So Howe Brothers goes, wait a minute. First of all, you're not a general, okay? And I know Continental Army, so let's get over that one, you know? So the bottom line is, Washington wouldn't come. And by the way, he was kind of busy getting his butt kicked in the Battle of Brooklyn. That's another story which we don't talk about that much. You know, biggest land battle, and it didn't work out. But he learned by his mistakes. He learned by his mistakes, and he learned, and he did well. But Washington knew there was a deal. There was something that the king had offered, all right? So he said, listen, I can't make it, but can I send three of my best men to go there, all right? He made the mistake of saying three men from the Continental Congress. And Lord Howe goes, no, there is no Continental Congress. You can't. Okay, I'll send three citizens. Great, okay. Who does he send? Benjamin Franklin, okay. Benjamin Franklin represented the Middle States, okay. Franklin, as we all know, he was a man of men, a Renaissance man. He was a diplomat, okay. And he also knew as a diplomat that through compromise you get results. Who did he put in next? John Adams. You know, John Adams, there is no compromise. Okay, so he said, Washington, you know, so the bottom line was, so you had John Adams representing, you know, the people in the North, okay, and they were rabid patriots. The South, who represented the South? A man named Edward Rutledge, okay? Rutledge was a patriot in every sense of the word, but he doesn't get much press from us up here because he was pro-slavery, and he believed that slavery was important for the South. So again, you had those three men, all patriots and all ready to defend what we have here in America. So that's why this house is important, because of the meeting that was held here. It was never called the conference house. That was a new term that was developed in the 1900s. You know, it was a marketing tool. We'll talk about that later. But it was always Bentley Manor. So I welcome you now inside into Bentley Manor, where the Billup family lived. Okay? Ashbet, let's go. Cotton was not up here and sugar. Okay? They couldn't do that. Right. And also as a plantation, okay? They had slavery. Okay? Mm. It was just, when I heard the plantation, as we all said, them Southerners, no, it's the same thing here. And even in Manhattan, it was.
So it was probably corn, wheat, things like that?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, in the money that the Billup family gave to the governor, it was basically in bushels of wheat. You know, so they did do a lot of wheat, but anything that you could grow, they grew, and they were dependent on themselves, all right? And also, too, with animals, same thing, you know, cows, sheep, lambs, ducks, the whole chickens, the whole nine yards. So they were self-sufficient as best they could. What they couldn't do, though, they couldn't do things like making pots and pans and nails and things. They had to trade for that, all right? And the closest trading post was Manhattan. Okay, and that was one day trip that way, a one day trip this way, on a good day. Yeah. Yeah, it's like buying a BQE, going on the car is the same thing. So anyhow, we'll go into the Billup family house. Okay, yeah. Come on in.
What kind of
okay, when people come here, the first thing they ask is when they come in the house, they say, is everything I see from the Billup family? And the answer is there is nothing here from the Billup family. Mm-hmm. And the reason why there is nothing here is that the Billups being loyalists, okay, and also Billup himself was like the head of the loyalists, okay, he was a big time operator. At the end of the Revolutionary War, in 1782, they passed something called the Bill of Attainder. And it said, if you held weapons against the patriots, okay, you have a choice. Stay here and get hung, okay, or go to Canada. All the rich went to Canada, okay? The poorer ones and the middle class people stayed because they had no choice, first of all. But over time and animosities, they did blend in, All right. So again, what you see here is not from the Billups, but what the Conference House Society tried to do is, what you do see here is Revolutionary War period stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, the clock is from 1729. The Bible box actually has 1748. The chairs are 1760. It's that period. So we want people to feel like you're in the period of the Revolutionary War. Okay? The first room, I guess I should keep going like my regular tour.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
First room, look in that one. This is what they call the dining room, okay? It's just an example of the Billups were wealthy. The Billups were wealthy and they loved to show their wealth and they loved to entertain. And at one time, they had a lot of people in the house. They had, the last Billup had 12 children. So it was a busy place. But the reason why I want you to see that more than anything is that if you remember outside, I mentioned about the house that the typical British colonist built in 1680, it would have fit in this room. That's why this house is a big, at the day, it was a big deal, all right? Also, too, when you say about the house, when you see closets, they never were in a continental house, okay? Because believe it or not, if you had a closet, you were built, you know, taxable. You must have something to put in there. So again, this is just an idea of, and every room having has a fireplace. Why is the house important? Why do I think the house is important? It's because of what happened in that room, right? Again, there's a lot of old houses. And everybody says, my house is older than your house. In Queens, they have older houses. In Brooklyn, they have older houses. That's not why this house is important. This house is a beautiful old house that is restored as best they could. But in this room is where they held the peace conference of September 11th, 1776. Let's get these pictures. They're from the Washington Post.
Oh,
yes, big shots. Okay. So the thing is, in this room, okay, is where the peace treaty was held. What happened was, to make a long story short, our guys, I mentioned the three fellas that were here, Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, and Edward Rutledge. They were based in Philadelphia because at the time, that's where our Continental Congress was meeting. So when they came across, they came literally from Pennsylvania up through, okay, New Jersey, landed in Perth Amboy, which is walking distance, if you can walk on water, right over there, all right? So the story goes, and here's like, this is a good part of the story. Theatrix, Lord Howe, okay? Lord Howe's here with his minions, okay? Our guys come, they get picked up by Lord Howe's barge, you know, the little British sailors there. So picture this, you got the sailors coming across and they're all with the little hats on, they're rolling across. They come over here, okay? And Lord Howe stands at the door. And literally, at the end of the hill is where they land, okay? They land and they come out of the boat, okay? And they come marching up the hill, all right? Franklin's first, Adams is second, Edward Rutledge is last. Marching up the hill. And at the time, this field is covered with redcoats. Those are regular British troops, Hessians, paid German mercenaries, killers, okay, and Scotch-Irish who hate everybody. So they're there, okay. Now picture our guys coming up this, right? Bagpipes are playing, drums are beating, sabers are rattling, and they know that just a couple of weeks ago, George Washington's army is on a run, okay? Because the British split us in half. In the Battle of Brooklyn, or Long Island, depending on what you want to say, we lost, okay? But again, we lost, but it worked out okay in the long run. But picture them coming up here, and they're coming up with all this stuff going on. They got their heads. Adams writes in his diary, I was concerned for my safety.
No kidding.
But he looks up at Ben Franklin, and Franklin's, It's only a show. He knew the drill, okay? And Rutledge was a young man.
So is it likely that the British fleet was out just out
here?
Here's
the deal. The British fleet in total was on the north end of the island. Okay, this is the island. This end of the island, no one's to live here. In the day, it was like, oh, South Shore. North Shore was like, now it's like all the hipsters on the North Shore, it's all hipsters. You know, but it's like that now. But again, because of the harborage and everything else, they were there and had access to Manhattan, so they were there. But picture, there were 400 ships. That's a lot of ships, okay? Yeah. And 40,000 troops. The reason why, too, the king was very upset about this war, or he wanted to end it, was that the British Navy was the greatest navy in the world, okay? Bar none. They could do whatever they wanted to do. But the British Army was teeny-weeny, okay? They didn't have an army to say. They didn't have the regulars to say. But that's why the king had to pay the Hessians, and that ticked them off, okay? Because a lot of money was going to that, all right? So here's the deal. They come up, they're at the door. Lord Howe's here, first one. He knows Ben Franklin personally. Franklin was a lobbyist in England, okay, and in France. He knew the Howe family personally. stories about Ben and how's sister is another story, but we'll talk about that. But they come to Ben, they come in, they shake hands, everything's fine. Second man comes up. How may I address you? I'm Edward Rutledge of South Carolina. Mr. Rutledge, please come inside. Third man comes up and he goes, and how may I address you, sir? I'm John Adams of Quincy, Massachusetts. You may call me anything you like except the servant of the crown. So even then, cards are on the table. Okay, so here's the deal. They go in the room here, as they say. They go in, and there's a table set, okay? And at the table, you'll see there's a deck of cards. I like to say that at the time, the British held all the cards, okay? And they were talking from strength. So here's the deal. They have a very cordial luncheon. They know each other. They're not savages. You know, we're not savages. We're educated people. They talk, chit, chat, chit, chit, chit. And finally, Ben Franklin goes, we hear that the king has an offer, okay? And then Hal goes, okay, down to business. Here's the deal. I like to do Lord Howe's Tony Soprano, because it really works. Now,
what an image.
Nothing, but you guys, like back in July 4th, you signed this thing you call the Declaration of Independence. You know, when you did that, you signed your lives away, okay? You became traitors to the king. And as traitors to the king, at the end of this war, you're gonna get hung, gonna die, and your family's gonna be destitute. You think about that. Right, on the table, right? So the guys are saying, you know, it's not a good thing, okay. But the king, in his mercy and his wisdom, if you lay down your weapons, lay your weapons down, the king will pardon you, pardon all of you, go back to your families. And then Howe goes, you know, not for nothing, but we know to stand back to talk. We know a lot of bullshit, you know, we know that, no, we know, we can fix things, you know, we can fix things, we can make things better, you know. Give us some time to work things out. So the three guys are sitting there saying, okay, I'm not going to get hung, they might make things better. Then Howe says, and by the way, America, you have a lot of natural resources. You have cotton, you have wool, you have trees, wheat, you have everything that we need. We manufacture. We can buy these things at fair prices. So, okay, I'm not gonna get hung. I could probably make some money on this deal. And if you were to help the king will appreciate your help. And there's a lot of dukedoms and earldoms and a lot of dumbs, you know? So, think about that. So here's these three guys saying, okay, I'm not going to get hung. I could make some money. I might become royalty. I would have said, looking Howe in the eye, can I talk to my wife just for a second? But they didn't. They didn't. And that's why this house is important. These guys that sat at that table, looked Lord Howe and the king through Lord Howe in the eye, okay, said, no, we will not accept your offer. We will wait and get our freedom. We will govern ourselves. And these men were not Bolsheviks. You have nothing to lose but our chains. They had everything to lose. They were wealthy, educated men. And they weren't perfect. They were not perfect men. And revisionist historians will tell you they were slaveholders and everything. And yes, they were. But they had a vision for this country. And they had the guts, or the chutzpah, as we say in New York, that, you know, we don't want to be governed by a king, a queen, or a monarch. When those guys signed that Declaration of Independence, they signed away their lives, they signed away their property, and they signed away their sacred honor. They had something in their guts that our politicians don't have. That's why this house is important. I'm done. Okay. Now we go upstairs to see how they do. Okay. The first thing we try to show them is this room over here, especially when there's children. Okay. We try to tell them this is where the kids played, where they slept. It would not be this beautiful bed here, because if we had it, we wanted to show it. But many of those small beds, okay? And at the end of the billet, the last billet who was here, you know, the Colonel Christopher Billet, head of the militia, he had 12 children, okay? Two wives. So not all the kids were here at once, but it was a busy place. And we show the kids, and these are all period pieces where they would sit, what they would do. What they would do on a desk, they would, no telephone, no this, no that. And they would, no TV. The thing that gets them crazy, though, is that the bathrooms. Where's the bathroom? Outside. You know, and it's like, that's the way it was. Speaking of that's the way it was, they always have exhibits here. And before you came, they had an exhibit on the role of women.
and the role of immigration. This exhibit basically is to say that we take for granted that we go to Macy's and get our clothes, or whomever we get our clothes from. They had to make their clothes, okay? This is flax. Flax made linen. Linen was the thing to make in the day, okay? So the bottom line was linen was what they did. This is all the equipment that made the shirts, the things that they wore, okay? When it came to the cow gave leather, okay? So they were able to do shoes. But like I mentioned once, what they couldn't do, they couldn't make belt buckles. They couldn't make things like that. They had to go to a trading post, and the closest one was Manhattan, all right? Which was a bit of a distance. So again, this is what we tried to do too. And what I try to do also, when people come, I say history is a wonderful thing. You know the answers. But try to put yourself in that period. Forget about what you know now, but put yourself into this Revolutionary War period where John Adams said 30% of Americans are patriots, 30% of Americans are loyalists, and 40% don't care either way. What would you do? Where would you be in this mix? You know something? If I was honest, I'd say, leave me alone. Leave me alone. I grew up with the king. Not a bad deal. I'm not a criminal. I have a farm. What would you do? And also, too, the men who were there, who had to make a decision, because they had to go to fight, okay? Not that they wanted to, but they had to, because if they didn't go, they were ostracized. And they knew that if they sold anything or whatever, people wouldn't buy it from them. So the men had to go and live in really pretty bad conditions and get killed, possibly, all right? But on the other hand, we talked about the great men. Picture the women, sorry. Picture the women that were left at home, okay, with young children. All right? So you have a farm, a small farm. You have to fend for yourself, okay? Small children, feed them, work the fields, do that, and then worry about robbers, Indians. You know, it was not a good time. But those were the heroes that no one talks about, okay? The little people that no one talks about. But put yourself there and say, what would you do? So again, with that said, in this room over here is where Mom and Dad had some semblance of. This is where the Mom and Dad had, well, I said it, Phillip's mom and dad. They had money, okay? We would not live in a room like this, okay? We would live in one of those little houses, little huts, but this is where they showed, they would kind of stick your head in, and you would see, like, you know, things that they would sleep in, use, whatever. It was a nice life for them, okay? And also, too, what I tell people is I would love this room, like in the bed and breakfast thing, this room on a cold winter night, with the snow hitting the windows, and the wind blowing outside, and the fireplace crackling, and I'm in that bed all cuddly-wuddly. I mean, it's a wonderful thing, okay? Also, too, in the room, too, on the right-hand side, you'll see a small crib, because the youngest child always stayed there. But you'll also see a table with the Bible box, okay? In the Bible box, okay, was the Bible, okay? Obviously, quote, the Word of God, unquote, all right? But it was a history of the family. In 1680, the access to records did really not exist that well. I mean, the courthouses wasn't there. The Bibles kept who was born, who died, who owned what, how many slaves, who owned the slaves, blah, blah, blah. So the bottom line was that was their history book. So you have incredible wealth over here for these people. And the word slaves came up because we always use the word servants, okay? Servants were indentured servants. Those were the white guys. Those are the white guys that came across, sold themselves for 7 years, okay, and worked as a slave, pretty much, okay, but then had freedom. Back to poverty and wealth. Behind the door up here, which we can't go up the stairs, this is the attic area, very large attic area, okay. This is where, at the time, they said that the slave girls, okay, lived, all right. Their job was to be up there, and in the wintertime they froze. In the summertime it was sweltering. But their job was to come down, take care of the kids, the fireplaces, the chamber pots, all that stuff they had to do, and then go back upstairs. The men folk, they lived outside in the things. If the young girl or the young man wanted to get married, okay, Philip would say, what a great idea. Because using horrible terms, they would breed. I mean, it's a horrible term, but that's the way they talked. So the thing is, you'd get more slaves, okay? And the thing about slavery in this area, in New York, is that when I was in college, you know, I did a paper, all right? Long story short, I said, what was the difference in 1855 between an African slave and an Irishman? The difference was the slave was worth something. The slave had a monetary value. The Irishman, they hope he died. Okay, they didn't want him here. Okay. So the bottom line was, yeah, no one was happy. But now, hopefully, we moved on from a lot of things. So, we saw the history lesson, we saw how the family lived, and now, okay, now we can go downstairs into the basement, the kitchen, okay? And as this house was redone, the walls were redone, this is redone, we go in the basement, it's pretty much from day one, all right? And I always touch the beams, and you'll see, because I feel history down there. The beams you see here, okay, came from the forest of Staten Island, which at one time, there was a forest of Staten Island. But the British Navy took care of all the good trees, okay, and took it back for their ships. But what was left was, that's the last thing we talk about is the floor. It makes no sense. It's good, though. Historically, it's fun. The bottom line is, this came from our forest. And picture this in the day where you had people with no equipment, no machinery, okay? Billop would send his minions, you know, his slaves and his servants to the forest. They would cut down a tree, you know, with a handsaw or you know, an axe, drag the tree back, take it and, you know, get it down to the, and then put it up on the top here. So the bottom line is, it was, you know, it was a pretty tough project, okay? So that's how this place was built, you know, the beams. The amazing thing is that this house is 330 years old. It's still square, okay? It's still square. And the amazing thing is, living on Staten Island, the basement doesn't leak. No, incredible to me, all right? So behind you, you will see, okay, obviously, the kitchen area, okay? Everything they made in the day, there wasn't the roaring fire that we see on TV during Christmas time. Everything was low and slow. It was coals, okay? In the morning, the servant girls or the men would take a big pile of lumber or whatever, burn it until it got down to be coals, then take the coals in buckets and throw it on the floor. Hang up the pots, okay? And they would do their cooking in here. A lot of soups, a lot of stews, a lot of small game, because it was easy to make. They had plentiful supplies of salt pork, salt beef, chickens. Everything was salted, and you know, that's the way they kept their food from rotting, all right? But food was plentiful. On Staten Island, they didn't starve. They were very, very good in that way, all right? So the bottom line is, that's what they did their cooking, and I mentioned to you that they did everything they could, except they couldn't make pots and pans and things like that. But they were farmers. Whether you were a patriot farmer or a loyalist farmer, you were a farmer. When the crops came in, you had to put them someplace safe, someplace refrigerated, okay? But there's no refrigeration. But they do have something almost as good. Now, you will hit your head if you don't listen to me. Follow me, okay? Follow me and keep your head down. Now, for city people, we would say, it's a great wine cellar. And yeah, it could be a great wine cellar, but it is a root cellar, as we know from, you know, people who are in the farms. This is where they stored all their stuff. When I say stuff, picture this room without this nonsense, because we don't have enough money to put anything anywhere, so we had to put it someplace. Picture this room filled with barrels. Barrels and barrels and barrels. You had salt pork, you had salt beef, you had salt fish. You had wheat, corn, barley, rye, okay? Anything in there. You had vegetables, potatoes and turnips and things. They would hold up down here. They would hold in this area too. They also had to make cider and ale. They had to, because in the wintertime, the wellheads would freeze and there would be no access to liquids. But by having, you know, cider and ale during the holidays, they were always very happy because they were shit-faced. So anyway, so a picture, like I said, small things just filled with barrels with stuff in there. This, where they cooked, okay? So we knew they cooked in there, all right? And also when they didn't cook in these things, they did their laundry, okay? They did their laundry with, you know, soap was basically animal fat and lye, and they did their laundry in there. We knew the Billops were here because there's a tombstone that we found, okay? And the tombstone has the name of Billop on it and the date and everything else. In the day, all the families buried their own on their property. Where actually these came from, we don't know. We know that they're in the general area, and we sort of think that on those big million-dollar houses, it's like poltergeists because they're under there, you know? So the bottom line is, we know that they were here, and because that they had their remains were here. So this is the room where they kept their stuff, all right? Take your time, take a picture, because I know you want to do that. And then, because historically, it doesn't make any sense, you know? But the thing is, it does make sense in a way, because when you're broke and you need to get the place fixed, you took anything you could. When the house was taken over by the city and then by the state and then by the federal authorities, they had to raise money, okay? They had to fix the house first. So they said, the first place we're gonna fix is the basement area, okay? So we need to get more bricks, because these bricks that you see here, okay, were the original floor. This whole floor was original bricks like this. They came on the bottom of Dutch ships as ballast, on the bottom of the Dutch ships, all right? They needed to get more of those bricks, all right? So as the legend goes, and I use the word legend because no one knows, as the legend goes, they needed more of these bricks. At the time, in the 20s, Staten Island made the most bricks in the Northeast. I mean, in Manhattan, before World War I, we were the guys that made it. We had a thing called Clay Pit Park out here. Clay Pit Park, that's where the clay came from, all right? So they used that for that. So as they said, they took a brick to the brick maker and said, can we get these bricks? We need about 1,000 of them. Guy said, I can give you all the bricks you want, but the dimensions and the color and everything, he says, they're European bricks. He says, I think they came from Holland. So as the legend goes, using the word legend, a young girl wrote to the Queen of Holland, Queen Wilhelmina, as we say, Wilhelmina, okay, and sent her a letter saying, we need 1,000 bricks, blah, 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 this and that. A few weeks later, letter comes back from Queen Wilhelmina, and she says, you know, America and Holland have been good friends, you know, I'll send you 1,000 bricks. Whoa, this is great. This is depression. This is, we have no money, all right? So, a few months later, down Highland Boulevard, the main drag down here, truck comes with a pallet full of bricks. The guy takes off the thing, and they look, and what they have her initials, Holland, 1929. Okay. Today, this would never go into the floor of a house, because we have PhDs that tell you exactly the way things were in the day, the whole bit. So this would never go there. But that in itself is pretty funny to me. But here's the best part. When they put the floor down, someone said, why don't we glaze some blue and glaze some, you know, and you don't do that, you know, but they did. And that's part of, like, history that makes no sense, but they did it, you know. And to continue the legend, okay, as, like, what went on, I use the word legend because I'm a novelist, come over here. This brick right here, this plain brick, as they said, was that in the day, Queen Wilhelmina actually did come here on a goodwill trip, and they allowed her to put the last brick in the floor. Okay. So that was the other thing in there. So again, that's something that doesn't make any sense, but historically it's fun. You know, it does. And you take, through the depression, you take what you get.
Oh yeah.
Right? And also to the last thing we'll talk about, here's the deal, this is the last thing I say. And again, legend, okay, these are legends, you know. And as a historical novelist, I love legends, you know. Here's the deal. In the day when the house was being rebuilt, okay, there were some Staten Islanders who were wealthy, okay, and they wanted to help build it because they knew the importance of the history of the house. There was a man named Cornelius Kopf, okay, and they actually named a ferry after him down the road. He was a very popular, you know, rich man. He gave a lot of money here, and Depression money, and that's a lot of money, okay. At the end of his life, when he knew it was over, okay, they said, Cornelius, we'd like to put up a plaque or a statue of you outside. And he says, no. He says, I just want one thing. Oh, Cornelius, what do you want? Put that in the floor. So here's the deal. A wealthy man, a capitalist pig, as we call them, you know, just said, you know, here, guys, that's all I want. So that's a nice way to end the thing.
So these here are original?
These bricks are from day one. And again, they came from Holland, and the bottom of the ships as ballast on the ships, all right? And the other bricks came from, you know, the brickyard in Holland, but not with initials and everything on it. Sort of interesting on that. Do you have any questions for me? 25 cents a question. Let's go.
What about the Indian burial ground?
The Lenape Indians, okay? We always talk about the English colonists and the Dutch colonists, because in 1680, you know, we think the English were here. Well, the English were here, okay? But also the Dutch were here. And before everybody was here, the Lenape Indians, okay? And down by the water, okay, you'll have not a burial ground per se, but you'll know they were there because people from the college, they sort of love when there's a hurricane and a storm, because as the water comes in, it washes away the seawall and all the flints and everything are exposed, you know. So they're down there. So we know the Lenapes were here, and there is a park not too far from here
the Lenape playground. But again, they were here. Where they actually lived, no one knows. They're here, but no one knows exactly where. Okay. Hi, I'm Dennis Gaffigan, a docent, meaning I'm a volunteer. Thank you for coming to the conference house. Thank you.
Well, that was the conference house tour. It was pretty interesting. I learned a few things. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Anyways, I'll see you guys later. Please don't forget to share, like, and subscribe.